Mr. Asoke Mukerji is a very senior diplomat. He has been described as one of India's greatest diplomats, peacemaker and peacekeeper personified. He has always aimed to create productive, sustainable and secure futures, not only for the citizens and government of India that he has served, but also for the world citizens. In addition to assignments in various countries, Mr. Mukerji has served as India's permanent representative to the UN between 2013 and 2015. During when he had spearheaded India's campaign for Security Council reform. Sir, welcome to the fourth column. Today, my first question to Mr. Mukerji is, sir, you have credited with spearheading India's campaign for Security Council reform and making the Council more representative by enlarging its permanent membership during your tenure as India's permanent representative to UN. In your view, what are the reasons that India has not got permanent membership of the Security Council?
Well, the main reason why India has not become a permanent member of the Security Council as yet is because the Charter of the United Nations has not been amended to create additional slots for permanent members. And India has tried very hard to get the support of the two-third majority of the General Assembly of the United Nations to amend the Charter, which is a requirement under the Charter itself. Once the charter is amended and extra seats are created, then the expectation for India is that India will be a candidate for the election to be one of the additional permanent members of the Security Council.
So in a way, it means that till the charter amendment, there is a no headway for India.
No headway for India. And the main reason why the amendment itself has been has not taken place is that the five permanent members are using either directly, like China, or countries which are friendly to them. They use a group of 14 countries known as the Coffee Club, which includes Pakistan, to block the negotiations. So what happened up to 2015 was that we made slow progress in bringing together a document which could become a resolution to be adopted by the General Assembly to amend the Charter. But in 2016, China led a counter-diplomatic move to block that document from becoming a resolution. And they convinced their friends to start offering new documents. Today, the situation is that the document of 2015 has been suppressed because of this diplomatic counter-offensive by China. And the only way that we can break this gridlock and restore the integrity of the negotiations is by getting 129 countries to table a draft of a resolution. And I think that we can do that because the document of September 2015 was put together by 122 countries. So if we can get the 129 countries to co-sponsor a draft of a resolution, then we can amend the charter.
So you had delivered an unusually strong speech at the Council debate on maintenance of international peace and security that focused on the principles of the United Nations Charter. You had called into question the commitment of permanent members to democratic principles. In introspection, what do you think was the motivation behind this?
Well, it's the motivation for a country like India is very clear. In 1945, when India signed the UN Charter, we were a British colony. So we didn't become part of the decision making in the Security Council. Great Britain was a permanent member. But in August 1947, when we became independent, one of the first initiatives we took was to become a non-permanent member of the Security Council. Now there is an unfortunate story about how we withdrew our candidacy in November 1947 and took the dispute on Jammu and Kashmir to the Security Council in January 1948. We were not there because we had opted not to be part of the Security Council as a non-permanent member. And the whole issue of Jammu and Kashmir was transformed from one of territorial integrity of India into what they call the India-Pakistan question. And the India-Pakistan question of the partition of India did not apply to the princely states. So when we became a non-permanent member for the first time in 1950, we understood that it was very important to be inside the room to take decisions. And you couldn't take decisions on issues of interest to you from outside. our experience gathered momentum as other countries became independent. And in 1960, for the first time, the General Assembly of the United Nations was dominated by newly independent countries. And the first major decision that was taken by the General Assembly in 1963 was to amend the Charter and expand the Security Council to get more of these countries as members. Now, our experience from 1963 to 1979 was that although many countries became non-permanent members, the substantive decisions of the Security Council were still held by the five permanent members because they had the power of veto. So in 1979, Rajesh Mishra, who was India's ambassador to the United Nations, and a group of 10 developing countries tabled this request for equitable representation in the Security Council's decision making. And this is linked, therefore, with India's own evolution as a democratic, independent, sovereign country, that we as a country which came out of colonial rule did not want to be in an organization which would be dominated by the former colonial powers of 1945. But unfortunately, from 1979 till 2019, this process has gone on in a very, very slow and incremental way. But the world will not wait. And today, for example, the disputes and conflicts across the five continents of the world have displaced about 70 million people, which is the highest number since the end of the Second World War. And the blame for this breakdown of peace and security is squarely on the Security Council. And within the Security Council, the blame is not on the 119 countries who have been non-permanent members so far, but on those five countries who have prevented the Council from being effective. And all that I have said was actually endorsed by world leaders unanimously in 2005 when they mandated the reform of the Security Council to make it more representative and more effective, and for its decisions to be implemented on the ground. These are words from the document. So I don't understand why, you know, countries will not want to reform the council and make it more democratic.
These are the inside insights you have given us. Sir, you had won accolades for your and the mission's role in nudging the SDG agenda towards the priorities set by then newly elected Prime Minister Narendra Modi. What are your views about this?
Well, you know, when we started the negotiations on what are called the Sustainable Development Goals, we had an inherited legacy and we had something to create new. The inherited legacy were the 8 goals, which we call the Millennium Development Goals, which were basically health and gender and some amount of education, but applicable only to developing countries. And these were goals and targets set by some processes outside the United Nations member states and given to developing countries to implement with no idea of where to get the finances, where to get the assistance to implement. So these were the 8 goals that we inherited. But one thing that we were able to do in the Sustainable Development Goal negotiations was to take advantage of the clear roadmap which was given by the new government in India in 2014, which actually focused on inclusive socio-economic development. And so, therefore, when you look at the end product of September 2015, when these goals were made part of the Agenda for Sustainable Development, these goals, each one of them mirrors the national priorities of governance in India as articulated by this government. And therefore, this was a very, very clear roadmap which we were able to put forward and which was endorsed by all our partners in the United Nations General Assembly, mainly by developing countries who have seen how India has developed, so they all want to take advantage of our own experience. The second thing that happened was that we learned from the lessons of the Millennium Development Goals and insisted that these goals must be nationally implemented. The resources should be generated nationally. And if there was a shortfall on resources, then the international institutions would have to have a commitment to fill the gap. And this was negotiated in July. And this is what we ended up with as part of the commitment on implementing, how to implement the goals. The third area was technology. By 2015, it was clear that technology could accelerate development. And India had its own Aadhaar card program, its own Digital India program. So these perspectives of bringing technology into development were integrated by India into the sustainable development goal policy. Now for us, it's important to make sure that every year when the goal implementation is reviewed by the United Nations, that we are not diverted either back to the old system in which people from outside would say whether the goals are being implemented or not, or whether data and statistics are going to replace actual reality on the ground. That is a very big danger in these multilateral negotiations. That's on the basis of statistics, people will give an assessment of whether the goals have been met or not, and not take into account the actual reality of what has happened on the ground. So it is our endeavor now to focus on proper implementation. And I have been advocating that India should take the lead in having a high-level focused approach on technology for development. And by technology, we are not looking at only high technology, but we are looking also at traditional knowledge technology, which exists in our societies. And we have given examples, and this year we hope to send 8 non-governmental organizations to New York when they review the Sustainable Development Goals and talk about their own experience in India of how they have been implementing in specific areas these goals. So this is a bottom-up, multi-stakeholder process. It's not only governments, it's non-governmental organizations, it's academia, involvement of everybody. Because otherwise, the implementation will become very, very difficult just for governments to do.
Sir, recently we had this World Yoga Day, which was commemorated on 21st of June. Not many people know that you played a very vital role in context. You had created a strategic momentum in favor of adopting the proposal made by the Prime Minister for UN General Assembly. Could you kindly elaborate on this?
So when the proposal was made by Prime Minister Modi in September 2014 for the United Nations to declare an International Day of Yoga, we were faced with a situation on how to implement this idea when there had been no discussions on the idea in the United Nations. Nor, in fact, had there been any discussions of this idea within in the Indian governmental system itself. So the first thing that we had to do was to find an agenda item on the United Nations General Assembly under which we could discuss and adopt a resolution on the International Yoga Day. We found a connection between the proposal made by the Prime Minister and the issue of global health, which had been actually part of the Prime Minister's speech. So we included the idea of having a resolution for an International Day on Yoga as part of the global health agenda of the United Nations. The second was to find a way in which we would be able to implement the idea quickly, especially because there had been no prior discussions in any committees of the United Nations or in any of the member states on this idea, on this subject. So we decided that to implement it quickly, we would take it into the plenary of the General Assembly, and we convened informal meetings of the General Assembly plenary to discuss this idea. The third was to have a simple majority of members of the General Assembly to adopt the resolution, which meant 97 countries. In that context, because we wanted to implement the idea quickly, we thought it would be fastest if we could attract countries which would generate a large amount of support among member states. And our decision, which I took in 2014, was to ask China to be the co-sponsor of this proposal. The Chinese agreed to co-sponsor the proposal, and I think that is one of the reasons why we had such a huge outpouring of support in the member states when they saw a proposal jointly sponsored by India and China. Eventually, we had 177 countries supporting a resolution to declare an International Yoga Day. The fourth point, and that was very important, was to galvanize public opinion for the member states of the United Nations to actually implement it in an appropriate manner. Because the condition of international days is that there will be no budget from the United Nations to mark the international days. So we had to integrate into the resolution that it would be voluntary, but we also had to make sure that it would, when being implemented, have the appropriate impact. And that brought in the Indian diaspora, which was very enthusiastic. It also brought in non-governmental organizations which were active in propagating yoga in countries across the world. So with the benefit of these two very big support structures, we were able to ensure that when the first day of yoga was celebrated in June 2015, it was a huge event.
Very good, sir. So now a question on trade. What do you think would be the consequences of the ongoing US-India trade war?
Well, I think that here the focus is on tariffs. And when we are looking only at tariffs and tariffs on goods, then the attempt of the United States is to open the Indian market for some of the goods that they want to export to India. And among the public domain discussions, there are goods like agriculture products, like chicken legs, for example, and so on. But I think in trade as it exists today, there is an integral balance between goods and services. And if we have, for example, US showing interest in accessing the Indian market in goods, then we have an interest in accessing the Indian market in services, especially for the services provided by our high-tech IT service providers who go there, who are capped under their H-1B visa program. So, the end result of this awareness is that any trade dispute between India and the United States will have to be settled on a mutually acceptable basis. And the mutual acceptable basis is something that we need to integrate into a solution. The broader dimension is that whatever agreement we reach mutually between India and United States would have to fulfill the basic principles of most favored nation and national treatment in the WTO. So every bilateral dispute needs to be resolved to be in keeping with the principles of international trade law. And I think that's very important for a country like India, because we have consistently upheld the integrity of a rules-based order in international trade. And by that we mean the WTO. We would not like it to be resolved on the basis of a domestic trade law like US has got of Special 301 or Section 301, because then the implementation and the thinking behind that is a domestic priority of the United States. Whereas our resolution should be on a globally accepted principle.
Now, India is known for its liberal behavior and generally restrains from taking actions like enforcing tariffs. But this time, very recently, India has conveyed a very strong message to the US by increasing the tariff on US products. What could be the implications of this new stance which we have taken?
Well, I have not seen the details regarding this, so I would not like to get into a discussion on something that I have not seen the details on. Perhaps we can avoid this.
So, how do you cherish the memories of having worked with different foreign ministers, and which of these have impressed you most?
Well, in my career, I worked closely with two foreign ministers as their private secretary. One was Baliram Bhagat, who had been deputy minister of commerce in Jawaharlal Nehru's cabinet and been the speaker of the Lok Sabha before he became the external affairs minister. He was a person who taught me a lot, especially about the linkage between domestic realities in India and foreign policy. He represented a constituency from Bihar, Ara, and in those days, the private secretary used to do everything. We were only 10 of us running the entire office of the foreign minister. Today, there must be 40 or 50 people doing that same job. So, he was a human being. A person who was willing to be patient and teach, and I learned a lot from him. The most important thing I learned from him was to give even the most simple of persons, say from his constituency, time to listen to what they wanted to say. And in international relations, if I apply it to listening to even the smallest country and giving them time and patience to understand what they want to say, I think it giving a lot of benefit in my own ability as a diplomat. That is something I learned from. The other foreign minister I was private secretary to was P. Shivshankar, who was probably a contrast to Baliram Bhagat. P. Shivshankar is a lawyer. He was a man in a hurry, and he was a self-made man. He had, as he used to often say, he used to shine shoes in Amritsar and became Foreign Minister of India. And he was from Andhra Pradesh. From him, I learned one very important trait, and that was that you should never let issues fester on your table. You should take decisions rationally. He was a lawyer and he used to insist on logic. But once you took the decision, you should implement it quickly so that you wouldn't let issues fester. And I think that was also something I applied in diplomacy, and it stood me in good stead. Now, these are the two foreign ministers that I work very closely with. But when I look back at my 44 decades in the Indian Foreign Service, two foreign ministers who made a very big impact were P.V. Narasimha Rao and Pranab Mukherjee. Both of them were cerebral. They were very well read. They knew issues very deeply. They spent a lot of time on reading on issues. And I think that the importance of going deep into issues to understand all the nuances is something that I saw having an impact in our foreign policy from these two foreign ministers, especially because they were both there for very long periods of time, 5 years at least, and they made an impact.
Yeah. You also might have met the prime ministers and various ministers during the visit to the countries you remained posted. Could you recollect any of the memories of some of these visits and share with us?
Well, the first memory I have is of my first assignment abroad. I was in Yugoslavia, in Belgrade, and we hosted the visit of Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. She came accompanied only by her two grandchildren, Rahulji and Priyanka. They were the two grandchildren, and our first job was to find a way in this non-English speaking country to find some way to look after the two grandchildren. So we were able to tap into the Indian community and find children of the same age who could interact with them. So that was an interesting experience. But in terms of the prime ministers themselves, I think the one I remember very vividly is the visit to Central Asia, which had just become independent, by Prime Minister V.P. Singh, accompanied by his foreign minister, who later became Prime Minister, Inder Kumar Gujral. And this was a very, very interesting visit, and the exposure that I got to the way these two leaders thought. They were the first non-Congress leaders I really were able to see forming a non-Congress government, and their approach to what today we consider to be part of our immediate neighborhood, Central Asia, was something that I will always remember. And of course, Mr. Modi himself, he came to New York twice, 2014 and 15, and both his visits left a very deep impact on me, because again, he was someone who was clear in his idea on what he wanted done. He was interested in getting it done and implemented. And I think that in both the Yoga Day proposal of his, as well as the Sustainable Development Goal alignment with the New India alignment, I was able to deliver on both of these. So I was quite happy that I retired with this positive experience.
So you have a unique distinction of becoming the only second Indian to be bestowed an honorary doctorate by University of East Anglia, one of the top universities in the UK, in recognition of your decades-long contribution to diplomacy. The first awardee of this honor was best-known agricultural scientist M.S. Swaminathan. What does this award mean to you?
Well, it means recognition of the role that India has been playing in multilateral diplomacy. I think when the citation was read out for this doctorate, it focused on the issues of development, but seen from an Indian perspective, which I have been able to articulate in my various assignments, multilateral as well as bilateral. And I think that there are three issues which are very important, and I really appreciated this award because of this. These three issues. One was that as a democratic, independent country, we have the right to voice our opinion in a democratic way. And no country or no force can suppress this right of ours to express our views based on our own interests. So this was the first point. The second was that we have a right and we have an aspiration to re-emerge as one of the big players in the economic and social landscape of the world. And I think the sustainable development agenda, if it is implemented fully, will ensure that India's emergence as one of the world's largest economies by 2030 would be sustainable. And I think that's very important. And the third is an area which is very often not spoken about, but I think we need to speak about, and that is India's contribution to the global human rights agenda. And this goes back a long, it has a long history. It goes back to the 1930s. Under the League of Nations, which India had joined as a founder member, there was a committee for intellectual cooperation. And one of the leading contributors to this committee from India was Dr. Radhakrishnan, who became the second president of India. And I think that if we look at the contributions made by thinkers like Dr. Radhakrishnan and others to the evolution of human rights as a global platform, then we will be able to take pride and also to take action to uphold these human rights. If we are missing from the human rights discussions internationally, then we will be doing ourselves a great disservice. And I think that that is an important thing that we need to keep in mind.
And what keeps you busy these days in your current areas of interest?
These days I have three areas of interest. One is in military history, seen from the perspective of the soldier, the individual, and not the state. And that has brought me to this institution, the United Service Institution, where I am an elected member of their Managing Council. And we have done work on bringing the stories of and the perspectives of Indian soldiers who have fought in wars, whether they were First War, Second World War, or the UN peacekeeping, in terms of what it means for the country and what it means for the society in our country to have these badges of honor and valor. The second area is completely different, and that is the use of cyber technology for development. And I have used to lead India's multilateral negotiations on cyber issues, but after retiring I have focused on not only the security of cyberspace, which is an important issue, but also the use of cyber technology for development. And this is an area where internationally there is no voice right now. And India, because of the way we have decided to use technology by Digital India, for example, now we need to make sure that the security of cyberspace includes the security of development using cyber technology. There's no discussion going on that. And that brings many issues like privacy issues, access issues, so many issues are involved in that area. And my third area, which I do a lot of pro bono work on, is on mentoring young people who are interested in India's foreign policy and the way ahead. So I am associated with some foundations which are active in this area, and I bring my experience and my contacts abroad to help these people to meet their objectives.
That's very encouraging for young people. Thank you so much for taking time out for the fourth call.
Thank you. Thank you very much.